I am not the same girl that you met last year.
Okay.
Okay? I am not the same person. So last year was my first time at the gathering, and I sat, I did not know, I came because PK was here. So I did not know Pastor Lashai, didn't know really much about her. And I came, and I was sitting down, minding my own little dignified Christian business, okay? Really quiet, taking it all in, like just not even thinking, why am I here? I don't really know these people, they don't know me, but God did an amazing thing. And while I was minding my own business, sitting there, okay, keeping quiet, going under the radar, God says to me, next year, you're going to be up there.
Come on now.
I didn't tell anybody, because I was like, these people don't know who I am. I didn't say no, but I was like, I didn't laugh either, but I was like, okay, we'll see how that's going to be. I'm just going to wait and see how that happens. And I forgot. Has God ever told you something?
Yeah.
And you don't say no, you don't believe it, but you just forget that he said it. You just forget. And I just went on with my little business, okay? I just went on with my life. And one day, Pastor Michelle calls me, and I'm thinking she's calling for something else. And she doesn't know, okay? She doesn't know that God said that to me. And I forgot that he said that to me. And then I knew PK was coming, but I didn't know that Tina was coming. So even when I saw the names, I was like, okay, I still didn't remember what he said.
Wow.
And she calls me up and she said, Catherine, God told me. And I was like,
what?
And then she said, but I couldn't do it because I had to wait for my husband to also hear from God. So that's how I knew that that thing was real. And I remember, wow, they had no idea what they're doing. So your obedience is never about you.
Amen, 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 amen.
Your obedience is never about you, because God used them to confirm what he said to me, and they had no idea. I forgot what he said. They didn't know. They heard at different times.
Amen.
That I was supposed to be here. They knew me was supposed to be here. They didn't even know that either. They didn't even know that either.
Come on now, come on.
They didn't even know. And I said, she's talking, and I'm like, yes, I can hear. Have you ever done that? Like something is happening, you try to keep it together, but you're remembering what he said.
Right.
Yeah.
He said it.
Right.
So just want to let you know that when God tells you to do something, even if you send a quick text, even if it's put $5 in somebody's hand, you don't know what God is doing.
Yeah.
You never know who's depending on that prayer that God promised. I want him to use me.
Yeah.
I don't want him to use anybody else.
Amen, amen, amen.
And that means being uncomfortable. That means showing up when people don't show up.
That's right.
That's good.
I'm going to show up because we're going to show up for the 5,000, but we're not willing to show up for the 10.
Oh, you better preach that word now.
Yeah.
How do you want God to trust you with the 5,000 if you're not going to show up for the 10?
That's
right.
You need the practice run.
Ooh.
You need the faith practice run.
Yes.
That's not even a message. You can grab it, no
that's
worry.
A rainbow right there.
That's a free one. That you got to show up when nobody's watching. Nobody knows that what you're doing. And what he said to me in my walks was, I know what you're doing.
Right.
They don't have to know. Don't even tell them. I know. It's not wasted. All the work that you're doing that nobody sees that gets scrapped up and it just goes unnoticed.
Yes.
It goes unnoticed. He's paying attention.
Yes.
He's paying attention.
Yes.
So today what I really want to talk about is what it takes to become to what calls who God calls you to be.
Yes.
It takes something different from you. So in 2016 there were some things spoken over my life. Has anybody ever spoken anything over your life, something big?
Yes.
And you believe that thing. Okay? God said you're going to the beach, you got the flip-flops, you got the beach towel, you got everything because you trusted that God said it.
Right, right, right.
And that's going to be evidence, right? It's going to happen just like that because he said it. And you believe it because you're a good Christian. He's never lied to you before, so you believe that he's going to do it. So you get ready for the beach.
Right.
Yes.
And then summer comes and goes and you didn't go to the beach. And then another season comes and there's no beach. And you're like, God, you said lack of grit. So I just wanted to set that up. We're going to talk about Jacob. I had no idea. I had the message back in February, and I had it all laid out. He gave it to me, and then he changed the whole thing. He had me walk the whole thing out. I wrote this book for other people. I wrote it for other people, not for me. I was good. Becoming Jacob, how to leave the all you behind and fight for the new you. I was good. Not that I had arrived, but that was not my problem. That was not the thing that I had to fight about. I'm not a fighter. I'm quiet. I just want to be in the background. That's the old me talking. That's not anymore. Not anymore.
Right.
But at the time, I thought God said, prepare the message, and I'll send you. And I said, okay. So I prepared that message so quick, you don't even know. Okay, God, I'm ready. Got my passport ready. I'm ready to go. Those people don't even know what's going to happen. And then he said, I want you to put that in book format. Like, but did you just tell me what to do? I already did it. Why are you adding more to the things that you want me to do? So I did it. But you know me, I write books, you know, like crazy. They just come out. Yes. They just come out. So I kind of forgot about it because I had another agenda. Mm-hmm. God calls you to do something, and you kind of do it, but then you have your own agenda. And I forgot about the book. I did not mean to be disobedient. I just forgot because I did it. I figured you told me to do it. I did it. But he wanted me to release it. Sometimes we do the thing and we don't release it.
Oh, God.
We don't release it. It's a half obedience. It's a half obedience. When you told me to start the ministry, I have the logo. I have a website. I did open the door. But are you showing up?
Oh, that's good.
Are you releasing it? Are you telling people about it? Have obedience. So we'll talk about Jacob today. And then I'll tell you a story because I'm a storyteller. I'm a storyteller. That's who I am. Okay? And I don't have to explain that to people. I don't have to defend it. That's who I am. And then we're going to put it together with a nice pink bow at the end. So we're going to be in Genesis. You don't have to go there. If you haven't read the entire story of Jacob, I'm really going to ask you to read it. It's going to take time. It's going to mess you up. But all of us are Jacobs. All of us are Jacobs. But we want to be Israel. And we don't want to be okay with being Jacob. We want to pretend that we are not Jacob.
That's good.
We want to pretend that we haven't been Jacob. How many times, how many years have we been Jacob? And we want to pretend like, I'm Israel. I'm changed. I'm God. I fight for who God and I win.
Come on.
We are Jacob. And that's okay. That's who we were created to be. And I'm going to tell you why it's okay. So Genesis 25, this is my favorite part. Verse 21, Isaac prayed to the Lord for his wife, because she was unable to conceive children. And the Lord granted his prayer, and Rebekah, his wife, conceived twins. But the children struggled together within her, kicking and shoving one another. And she said, if it is so that the Lord has heard our prayer, then why am I this way? So she went to inquire of the Lord, praying for an answer. If you called me out here to do something and I was obedient, why is it crazy? If I was obedient, I stepped out because you told me to do it. Why is it this way? Why do I feel this way? Then she had to ask him, listen, my husband prayed for children. You touched me. I was able to conceive. Now these kids are fighting inside of me. Why is this so? You said it and it happened. Why is it so? I'm being obedient, God. Why is it crazy? I'm doing what you told me to do. When her days to be delivered were fulfilled, behold, there were twins in her womb. The first came out reddish all over like a hairy garment, and they named him Esau. Afterward, his brother came out, and his hand grasped Esau's heel, so he was named Jacob, one who grasped by the heel, soul planter. Isaac was 60 years old when Rebekah gave birth to them. I want you to remember that. Mm-hmm. How Jacob came out. Mm-hmm. I want you to remember that.
Jesus.
I want you to remember that. Struggle and a half, guys. Hasn't it been a struggle and a half?
Yeah,
just to get here.
And I live here. Yeah.
And we think that it didn't have to be a struggle.
Come on now.
We want it to be easy. I always want it to be easy. I don't want it to be complicated at all.
My God.
I always want it to be easy.
Yes. Hallelujah.
I always want it to be easy.
My God, my God, my God, yes. Hallelujah.
Thank you, God. Now when Isaac was old and his eyes were too dim to see, he called his elder and favorite son Esau and told him, "My son Esau," answered him, "Here I am. Go make me something." You know the story. And Jacob was alerted by his mother. "Hey, your father is about to give out the blessing. You gotta do something. You follow what I'm saying, and you're gonna get the blessing."
Yes.
And many times we are mad at Jacob. That's what I learned when I was growing up, that people were mad at Jacob because he took the blessing. Listen, if that's what I have to do to get my blessing, if you're not gonna appreciate the blessing, I'm going to take the blessing from you.
Come on now.
If you don't want it, I want it. We don't want it bad enough. Mm. We want to be so polite, quiet, and dignified.
Come on now.
Jacob, listen, he wanted that blessing. So he worked. He wasn't even into that stuff. He worked for that blessing. And we want to be mad at him. He did what he had to do. He worked that thing out. He worked it out. He worked it out. And you know what happened next? Esau got really mad, said, "I'm gonna kill you." And he was strong. He was very strong. So he did not wanna be there when Esau came to his senses. So he's like, "I'm gonna get out of here." So chapter 28, now Jacob left for Sheba, never to see his mother again, and traveled toward Haran, and he came to a certain place and stayed overnight there because the sun had set in, taking one of the stones of the place, and he put it under his head and lay down there to sleep. I love this so much. So he's running. He got the blessing, but he's running. He's running. And he put his head on a rock. So he was between a rock and a hard place, literally. Literally, he put himself there.
Yeah.
A rock and a hard place, and we are all there. We all have been there. And what we want to say is, "I'm out. This is too hard for me. Why am I here? Why did you bring me out here to leave me like that? To look all foolish. I'm in a hard place. What is going on?"
Come on now.
Why am I in this hard place? And we don't even realize that it takes a fight.
Yeah.
When you're working out, those of you that work out, why do you think they have you doing weights? What do you think the weights are doing? They're building resistance.
Yes.
That's how the muscles come. So when Jacob was in the hard place, between the hard place and the rock, literally, God had to talk to him and show him some things. In the hard place, we wanted to come when we're sitting comfortable, on the couch with the seat up. That he's not gonna do that. You're not gonna be able to hear. You're too comfortable. So he puts you in the hard place so you stop being distracted.
Yes.
And then you have to look up because you are in the hard place. The hard place is a gift, but we don't want it because it's hard. It's
good.
Building something inside of you. It's building something. Do you think that if we all would take a pill and get muscles, we all would do it? There
would
be any strength in those muscles? There wouldn't be any strength.
Yes.
There was no push.
Right.
Come on now.
There was no push for those muscles.
That's good.
And when you work for it and you get those muscles, listen. You think twice about not taking care of your body because you know what it took.
Yes.
to get there.
Preach to me.
So when you offer me a cake, when you offer me something foolish, you know what I'm going to say? Listen.
Yes.
You don't know what I had to do to get here.
No.
You don't even know. Don't offer me that thing. I don't need that in my life. I know that I have to work for that thing.
Yes.
And that little thing is not going to tempt me anymore. Anymore. It has in the past. Not anymore. Because I know how hard it was to get. I know how hard it was to get.
Amen, amen, amen. Amen.
Jesus. So then now Jacob gets another blessing from the Lord while he's there. He has a dream. And then the Lord says, stood above him and said, I am the Lord, the God of Abraham, your father's father, and the God of Isaac. I will give it to you and to your descendants the land of promise of which you are lying. Your descendants shall be as countless as the dust of the earth, and you shall spread abroad to the west and the east and the north and the south, and all the families, nations of the earth shall be blessed through you and your descendants. Behold, I am with you and will keep careful watch over you and guard you wherever you may go. And I will bring you back to this promised land, for I will not leave you until I have done what I have promised you. Listen, I will not leave you until I bring that thing to pass.
Right.
We get into the desert and we're like, God is gone. He has done forgot about me, and he forgot what he promised me. But he said, I will not leave you until I bring you to pass.
Yes.
And it takes a hot minute, and we're thinking it's not going to happen anymore.
My God, my God.
He takes one moment, and we say, forget it. God forgot about me. It's not going to happen anymore. But he promised. Now, I'm sure if I were Jacob, I would be really excited. So Jacob got up early in the morning and took the stone he had put under his head, and he set up as a pillar that is a monument to the vision in his dream.
Amen.
And he poured olive oil on the top of it to consecrate it. He took the hard place and he built something with it.
That's good.
He took a hard place, something that was useless, something that brought tears to his eyes and his body, and he built something with it. What do we want to do with our pain? We want to hide our pain. We want to hide our story and say, that thing did not happen. It's behind me. I'm saved. I'm going to heaven. I know who I am. Let's not talk about the hard thing. Let's forget about the hard thing. I'm not going to do anything with it, but he gives it to you so you can build something with it. It is the foundation.
That's good.
And when you have a firm foundation, you're not going to fall when you go back to being comfortable. Because you remember what it took for you to get there. You have built the foundation. You have the relationship. You know what it's like to have it. So you don't want to go without it anymore.
Right.
Because you know what it's like.
Amen.
So I'm thinking Jacob is like, I did my monument thing. I'm good. I'm good. This thing is so good. This thing is so good. God for sure is going to bless me. For sure he's going to bring it to pass. For sure he's going to bring it to pass. But that's not what happened, did it? His life is a whole mess. A hot mess.
Come on now.
He went to his father-in-law, who was another trickster. He had nothing on Jacob. Jacob had nothing on him. Messed with him, lied to him, tried to take things from him. But the whole time, what God showed me was that the whole time, Jacob, you know, at the beginning when they described Jacob, what did they say about Jacob? That he was a peaceful man. He dwelt in tents. The one that was a fighter was Esau. He loved that. He was muscular. He loved hunting. He was all about that. But Jacob was so peaceful. So peaceful. And what God had to do was put him in a hard place so the real him can emerge. The real him had to emerge. He was not called to be peaceful. He was not called to dwell in a tent. He did not call me for me to be quiet and be like dignified and thank you, Jesus. No, that's not my portion. That's not your portion either. You got to be a fighter.
Yes.
You got to be a fighter.
Hallelujah.
And you want to be quiet. Mm-hmm. You want to be cute. I want you to like this. If I tell them off, listen, sometimes you got to tell people off. In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus. You got to tell people off.
In the name of Jesus.
Because they ask all kinds of crazy, and you want to let them, because now you're saved. I got a shirt that says, I'm safe, but I got hands. Amen.
Where did you get it from? I need one.
Jesus. Yes. I'm safe, but I got hands. Don't you try me. Don't you try me, because I got hands.
Yes.
Yes.
That's a good shirt.
It's a good shirt. It's a good shirt.
Yes. Preach that word now.
So Jacob had to change.
Yes.
His whole life was a hot mess. He was a liar and a cheater. And he didn't know he was a fighter. He didn't know he was a fighter all that time. He thought he was just living his life. He was fighting.
Yes, oh God.
He was fighting. Don't you remember when he came out?
That's right.
He had his hand on the ankle and brother, I'm coming for mine.
Yes.
I'm coming for mine. And you don't know that you have been fighting your whole life. So many of you maybe don't know that I'm from an island. I've been this tall since like 12. Okay? Always been this tall. Maybe I weigh maybe a little less, but I was always this tall. And I play volleyball a little bit. So I'm gonna just tell you my story now. And allow me to go to sports. I'm not really big into sports, but you know, that's what God wanted me to do. That's what I'm gonna do.
Go there.
So I played volleyball a little bit. So when they saw me, what do you think they thought?
You could play.
We're gonna put her in the front.
Yeah, she can spike.
She can spike. So I was excited about the game because it's not boring. But what happens when you play volleyball? There are six positions.
That's right.
I don't know if you've ever seen that, but there's six positions. The person in the back, has to be strong enough, have to throw the ball, and then you have to throw it all the way to the back of the other court. All the way to the other back of the court. But if you're brand new to the game, they're not going to put you on the front. You know what they do when they teach it to you? They teach you to play from the back.
Right, they do.
And all the while, you're looking at the person in the front, and you want to be the person in the front.
Right.
But you don't know what it takes to be the person in the front. You want to be in the front, but you don't know what that person had to do to get there.
Yes.
And you got to be in the back. And you stay in the back until you can make that ball go from the back all the way to the front. And all you're doing is this.
Right, right.
All you're doing is this.
Serving, yes.
All you're doing is this.
Yeah, catch that.
All you're doing is this.
It's serving, yes.
All you're doing is this.
That's good.
And then eventually, when you get good at that, they'll put you in the middle.
Right.
Now you're closer to the front. Now you can smell the front.
Yes.
Now you got closer. But what do you do in the front? It gets harder in the front.
It does.
Because now you got to receive. Not the good stuff either.
Right.
You receive the hard stuff. You have that girl that has to miss one meal, and she throw that ball at you, and it comes hard.
Yes.
You put your arms together.
And you bump that thing up. Yes.
Yeah. It doesn't go far. The person that receives the ball, he doesn't go far. Because it's so hard, you can barely receive it.
Right.
You can barely receive it. And it's not so fun to be in the middle. It's not the popular position.
Right.
Nobody wants it because it's hard.
Center.
Now you're thinking, I thought the back was hard. I thought the back was hard. Now I'm in the middle. I'm closer to the front. And it has gotten harder.
Right.
Why did it get harder? I thought that the back was hard, and all I'm doing is this.
Six.
And it's barely moving. The
needle
is not moving. I'm showing up every day on Facebook, and people are not showing up.
Mm-hmm.
I'm preaching every day, and people are not getting it. They're still acting out. I am being a good parent to my kids, and they don't get the sacrifices that I'm making. The needle is not moving, God. What is going on? You called me to do this thing.
Mm-hmm.
So when I was playing the game, I moved fast. Sometimes you move fast. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
And then move you all the way to the front. I made it.
Yeah.
I made it. I'm in the front. I'm in the front real quick because I got the legs. I can do it. They're thinking I can do it. I made it. I was in the back. I was good. I was in the middle. I was good. But it was too fast.
Oh, that's good. Now that's good.
Say it. It was too fast.
It was too fast.
So when the receiver got the ball, gives it to the setter, and now the setter gives it to me. I'm looking at the net. And because I was not long enough in the back,
right.
I was not long enough in the middle,
that's good.
When I'm gonna about to jump, my low self-esteem and my lack of confidence and my fear did not allow me to jump as high as I could jump. Because I didn't see myself as God saw me. I have the legs. I could jump. I have the strength. I could not.
I'm in the game.
I'm in the front. They're trusting me with the ball, and I could not jump.
Wow.
I could not jump. You know what happened? They took me out of the game. They took me out of the game because I looked good, but I couldn't perform. I had the strength, and I couldn't perform. I could jump. I couldn't perform. They took me out of the game.
Wow.
Do you know how much that hurt? Do you know how I basically cry the whole time? You know when you have to cry on the inside because you have to look cool?
Right.
And you have to keep it together?
Yeah.
I cried because I wanted to be. That was made for spiking. I was made for that. I knew that. But when I was about to jump and that ball was coming at me, I paralyzed. I froze.
Yeah.
I could not hit that ball. So I walked away from the game.
Wow.
Because when they put me in the game, I was getting in the way of the other players because I stood.
Jesus.
I was holding up somebody else's blessing. So they took me out because I was a hindrance instead of being part of the team.
Oh.
They kicked me out. They kicked me out of the game. My game. I was made for that game.
That's good.
Everything about me is about that game. Listen, why am I this tall if I cannot play that game? Why do I have this voice and this anointing if I cannot preach? What's the point?
Come on now.
What's the point?
Come on now.
They're not going to come. They're not going to show up. And you made me this way. You made me different for a reason. Now you're going to put me in a church where women cannot preach? Are you serious right now? Are you serious right now?
Come on.
So I cannot use this voice that you gave me? What's the point?
Come on.
What's the point?
Come on now.
I left the game.
Yay.
I couldn't play. You know how frustrating that is? When you know that you have the skill and the ability and you're watching people spike and you see yourself spiking. Listen,
My God.
Is exciting to spike.
Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
It is exciting to spike. But not everybody can do it.
Right.
I don't care how tall you are.
Right.
I don't care how gifted you are.
Right.
I don't care if you have the position.
Right.
And the funny thing is that there are two spikers. There are two spikers.
Spikers.
And the funny thing about the game of volleyball is that the setter is in control.
Yep.
The person that is right in the middle, there's the person that receives the ball. The setter moves wherever the ball is.
Right. The setter
moves wherever the ball is. Nobody else is supposed to touch that ball, only the setter. God is the setter.
That's good.
God is the setter. And he never drops the ball.
Yes.
He never drops the ball. And we as the spikers, we want to tell the setter where to put the ball. Listen. We want to tell him where to put the ball. But the setter doesn't care where you want to be.
Huh.
The setter never puts the ball where you are. And there are several, there are the two spikers, and the setter will look at who is in position.
Yes.
You didn't get that.
Yes. I got that.
Who's in position? The setter will not send it to you if you're not in position.
Yes.
And you know what happens with us? When we want God to use us, jump and you are in position or so you think, you know what happens? You quit because you did not use you. But you were in position every single time. She didn't quit. She didn't move from there. But he did not, he got you out of the game. Because when he was, when you were ready, when you thought you were ready, and he used somebody else.
Right.
He said, what are you doing? Why are you out of the game? Just because are you gonna be with the left? Are you giving me attitude because I did not use you when you thought I had to use you? You're not the setter. I'm the setter. You're not in control. I'm in control. Yeah. You don't know my timing. Yeah. I know the timing. Until you get to be strong enough that when you jump and the ball is out there, you're going to jump again the next time.
Right. Hallelujah. Yeah.
Are you listening? And you got to jump every time, even though the ball is not there. You still have to jump because one day the ball will be there.
Yes.
He's watching every jump. He's watching every jump. Nobody's paying attention.
That's good.
17 books. Nobody's reading those books.
That's good.
You write another book.
Yes.
And you write another one. And one day, when I know you're ready, Jesus. When I know you're listening to me, he's going to take one more book.
Yeah.
He's going to take one more drum. He's going to take one more drum. When he sees your arm looking all kinds of eyes, and he's been using your sister over there, She's getting every ball.
Jesus.
And then one day you're here and you're like, you know what? I'm gonna stay in position.
Yes. Hallelujah.
You start paying attention. She's staying in position.
Jesus.
Even though she gets the ball, the other one is jumping. Even though she's getting all the accolades, she's still jumping over
that's
here.
Right.
Yeah! know.
You just never know.
That's good.
The funny thing is that God wants to use you. But your amnesia is getting in the way.
Amnesia. Come on, talk about it.
Come on now.
Your amnesia is getting in the way.
Oh, that's good.
You remember when Jacob came out of the womb and he had his hand on the ankle? Mm-hmm. But then, like right after, it says that he was a peaceful man mm-hmm. and that he dwelt in tents. Mm-hmm. How many things have you been fighting for your whole entire life? Mm-hmm. You've been fighting some things your whole entire life. There are some things that you're fighting growing up. I heard these words my whole entire life for 18 years. Then these to me are four-letter words. I do not accept it. I do not allow in my presence the word stupid and idiot. Mm-hmm. I don't allow those words in my environment because I heard them so many times. And I remember being very little. I walked to a dictionary and I looked it up and I said, that's not me. I reject that. I mean, I was young.
Come on now.
And I said, that's not me.
I know
that's not who I am, but I heard it so many times. But there were other things that I heard. There were other things that I heard. I didn't look those things up. I didn't say that I was not those things. I fought what I could see.
Oh, that's good.
And I was good at fighting those things because something inside of me told me I was not those things. But then they said, you're ugly. And I say, really? Because I don't know. Yeah, you are. I mean, think about that. You don't reject that thing.
Right.
You don't reject it. Mm-hmm. And they say it so many times that you're like, I am.
Uh-huh. Oh, that's good.
And you walk into that thing. And you act like you are that thing.
That's right.
That's good.
Because your amnesia got in the way, and you forgot that you fought the idiot and the stupid before.
Oh, that's good.
So
that's
why
good.
Did you accept the ugly?
Right.
Why did you accept that you're not smart enough? Why did you accept that you're too dark, that you're too light, that you're too skinny, that you're too whatever? Right. Amnesia. So Jacob, because he did not look like Esau, hello? He didn't serve like Esau. He believed that he was a quiet man and he was a tent dweller. He was a tent dweller? That's not true. Because when he was in his mother's womb, he was a fighter.
Yes.
He was a fighter. But he got amnesia. And he believed that he was a quiet man and he was not a fighter. But if you keep reading his story, he fought for everything. He fought for his wife. You got the ugly one? And he didn't stand for that.
That's what the word says. That's what it says. Yeah.
It's in my book.
That's what it says, right?
Right. That's what it says.
And Jacob said, I reject that. I rebuke that. I want the pretty ones.
That's right.
So there are some things in your life that you have rejected, but there are others that you are not rejecting. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. When lack comes into your life,
Jesus, my God.
Okay, I guess this lack thing is in my life. I'm obedient, Lord, so if you want me to be here, excuse me?
Come on now.
So you're going to fight for some things and you're not going to fight for the other stuff?
Mm-hmm.
Why are you accepting and walking on that thing? Like it's your birthright.
Mm.
And you're just like, well, you know, God, if this is the place that you want me to be, if this is the place that you want me to be, and you sit in that thing, you sit in that place of rejection, and you just take it. Your kids start acting crazy, and you're like, well, you know, life, you know, times are different now. Kids will do what kids will do. I guess that's the way it's going to be. And we just sit there. And then it's another thing. You know how people, this is my favorite. You know, I'm in the ministry. You know how to say ministry? I'm broke for Jesus. Instead of that, I'm broken. This is what God wants me to do. And they're actually proud of that thing. I'm broke for Jesus. And this is what being in ministry means. I'm broke for Jesus. I'm like, that's not what my Bible says. And they're proud of that thing. And they're okay with that, counting pennies. And eating in at the wrong places and hanging out with the wrong people because that's the season. No, that's not the season. That's what you are accepting.
That's good. That's good.
You're accepting that. You're not fighting for your next thing.
Jesus.
You're not fighting for your next thing. You're believing that that thing is the way it's supposed to be. It is amazing the things that we allow to be in our lives for far too long. Mm-hmm. Like a minute is too long. Mm-hmm. How many years has it been?
Come on now.
It's been a long time. Mm-hmm. And we just go with the flow. We are accommodating too. We let that thing stay. And then you're so proud. Well, you know, I'm broke. But what I do is, you know, I pay this bill. And then when that bill comes, then I pay the other bill. Listen, I'm a waste of this thing. I'm working this thing out. Ain't nobody else that you are like me. You don't even know.
Come on,
you
now.
Don't even know the things that I'm doing. I'm making it work. No. You're not making it work. You have settled.
Come on. That's good. That's good. That's good.
Come on.
Ha.
You're not making it work. You're not making it work. You have accepted something that God had not intention for you to accept.
That's right.
No intention whatsoever. No intention whatsoever. So you have accepted that thing. That's your identity now. And you talk about it. I meet people all the time and they introduce themselves and the stories they choose to tell me about themselves. I'm like, I have never seen you before. And this is the story that you're choosing to tell me?
Oh my God.
Why is this your identity?
That's good.
I've never met you and you're gonna tell me that about yourself that happened back in 1995? Seriously?
Right.
So you tried back in 1995 and now we're on this all these years later and you're still talking about it?
Come on, man.
And now you're telling me why it's not gonna work for me, but you haven't been in the game.
Come on now.
You haven't been in the game. And you're gonna tell me how to play my own game?
My God.
Listen. No.
No.
Yes.
I love you, but no. No. This is my game. This is how I jump. Don't tell me how to jump.
I love you, but no.
Don't tell me how I jump. Are you telling me that I'm jumping too early? They'll tell you that you're jumping too early for that thing. They're not even walking it out. They're not even in the court, and they're telling you that, you know what? If I were playing the game, if I were you, but you're not me. The way I jump, you don't know the things that I have to do. I jump and I know I have to jump.
Yes.
And I don't have to explain to you what I'm jumping when I'm jumping.
Yeah.
I don't owe you any explanations.
Right.
You don't get it? I don't care that you don't get it. It's not for you to get.
Right.
You did not call me to jump.
Right.
You don't have to get it. But we want to be so nice to people. Well, look, what happened was that I pray and I did this. You know, I pray and I fasted and, you know, I was seeking the Lord and he said that I can quit my job.
Come on.
And I was trying to explain to them. They were having a hard time with my jumping.
Right.
Oh, that's good. That's good.
Is it affecting you that I'm going through? Are you out of your mind? So you are more bothered that I'm going through because I was obedient that I am. So it bothers you that I'm out here doing this.
Right.
Okay. And you're not even in the game.
Right. And you're not even in the game.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
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 It bothers you. There are some things that you have to do that are not going to make any sense.
Yes.
My God.
They're not going to make sense. And you don't have to explain why they don't make sense. They don't have to know what's behind the decision.
That's right.
Oh,
they don't
good.
Have to know what you're fighting. Mm. They don't have to know why you're fighting. Did you know? And I haven't shared this, and maybe that's why I haven't published the novel that I wrote. When I quit my job, I've been praying to quit my job for 14 years. Hmm. I've been praying and waiting for God. He was waiting on me to be ready. Yeah. Because he knew how many times I was going to have to jump and nothing was going to happen. My cute little legs were not going to be able to hold me up. So the 14 years, I'm thinking, I'm waiting on God. God is waiting on me. Hmm. So it got to a point, it was so bad, that I would be at my job, and they had, it was on the fourth floor, and they had like a whole suite of offices. And in order to go from one side to the other side, you can go the long way, or you could take a little shortcut. But if you took the shortcut, there was a little balcony thing that it was open to the lobby, so you can actually see the lobby. So sometimes, because I didn't know, I was going to a meeting that was here, and I was here, I wanted to do this. But if I went the long way, I would have.
Come on now.
To do this. Uh-huh. So I was doing that. But every time I did that, I would hear a voice that say, if you hated someone, share, why don't you jump? Mm. Every time. Mm. Every time. So you know what I did? Okay. I ain't gonna jump. Uh-huh. Right. I ain't gonna jump. So when God said you can quit your job because he got that bad and he gave me permission, I didn't have to tell people that if I didn't quit that job, I was going to kill myself.
See? Oh, my God, my God.
And you're telling me that I didn't have to quit?
That's good.
You want to understand why I had to do it? You don't know what I'm battling.
Come on now.
Oh,
that's good.
You don't know what I'm going through.
Yes.
You don't know what I'm going through. You told me to stay. You don't know what I'm doing. You don't know what God is doing.
That's right.
I quit the job. I got the word. God's going to do with my business, with my ministry. It's going to be amazing. I'm good. I got my flip-flops on. I'm going to the beach, right?
Yay.
I didn't get to go.
Okay.
And I'm waiting, and he said to quit. I said, okay, I did it. What's going on here? And the ministry's looking funny, too. And I'm like, oh, see, you should have quit that job. You're making six figures, see? Mm-hmm. Now you're with those people. Now you don't even know what you're doing. See? Mm-hmm. See? Nobody's ever in our family made that much money. What are you? Are you crazy? Wow. You're going to quit that thing? That was a bad decision, see?
Jesus.
And this, what is all this Jesus stuff? What is all this stuff? What?
Come on now.
What are you doing?
Right.
All the time. You hear that, and then you're like, oh. But God, you said, remember what Rebecca said, if my husband prayed over my womb, and you opened it, and you gave me twins, why do I feel this way?
Come on now.
Why is the struggle
Jesus
said to do it?
Yeah.
So she said, Rebecca said, she inquired of the Lord.
Yes.
So I don't know if you have inquired of the Lord and you have asked them, why are things this way?
Right.
Because when we ask the right questions, when we ask the right questions, he answers quickly.
Yes,
he told us the reason why is because there's something big inside of you and it's so big that you have to wait it out.
Jesus.
There is some fighting going on. Remember when Daniel prayed? And he can pray, and he can pray, and nothing was happening. But the angel had to start the fighting to go tell him, man of God, the moment you gave the word, God sent me out, but let's be the fight.
Come on,
that's the fight in the spiritual realm right now. And we don't even know about it. The victory is yours, but we're fighting for you. I can't believe you went there. I mean, I know after one now? Oh,
come on now.
I'm taking my earrings off. Fighting his whole life. That identity followed him His whole life. His whole life. Whatever you were called before, you were called some things. And you have attached your full name, your whole being to that identity. Mm-hmm. And if you're not even acting on it, you don't even look like it, but because they said it so many times, you thought that that was the case, and you're living a completely different life, but you don't even know. You don't even know because that's what they said, so you believed it. Jacob, getting to the end of his life, he's like the end of the road. So Jacob, Genesis 32:30-24, mm-hmm. So Jacob was left alone. And a man came and wrestled with him until daybreak. Mm-hmm. Some versions of the angel of the Lord, many people think it was Jesus. I believe he was fighting with Jesus. That's what I think he was wrestling with. And it got to a point, I'm trying to think, why did he wrestle? He's about 100 years old. We know that angels are very strong. But Jacob got to a point where he's like, I'm not a peaceful man. I'm done with being who I am. I'm not gonna take that anymore. I'm not that person anymore. I'm not that person anymore. I'm fighting. I'm remembering. Even when I told you that you had amnesia, you've been fighting your whole life. But there are some areas in your life that you have decided to give up. There are some areas in your life that you said, I have no control over that. And that is a lie. That is a lie. You can speak to things that are not as though they are.
Amen.
Yeah. I was doing a broadcast the other day, and I was talking about, and when I'm preaching with my husband and we're tag teaming, and this lady, people are always mindful of your business. Like, they know all of your business. Why do they know all of your business? All of your business. And just like, oh my God, amen, woman of God, you're married now. God is faithful. And I said, listen, I'm speaking things that are not as though they were. I am married. It's just that where I'm jumping, we haven't met yet. We haven't collided yet, but I'm already married. And we are already talking. We're already preaching. So you know what? I'm just speaking that thing and I'm not on my business. But I'm thinking, why is she keeping track of my business like that? I don't know why. I don't know why. But in this season, we got to stop accepting what is, like it is your final destination. Right. It's not your final destination.
Thank you, God.
It's not your final destination. There are some things in your life that you have to speak over, and you have to tell them no more. Yes. When the man saw that he had not prevailed against Jacob, he touched his hip joint, and Jacob's hip was dislocated as they wrestled with him. Then he said, let me go, for day is breaking. But Jacob said, I will not let you go unless you declare a blessing on me. The reason why we have to become Jacob is because Jacob was never afraid to fight for what was his.
That's right.
He fought with the Lord himself.
Come on now.
For what he wanted.
Come on now.
How many times do we ask for something and then we don't get it real quick and then we're like, I guess he was not in the Lord's plans for me.
Yes.
Maybe it's not the Lord's timing for me, but why do you give up so easily? Why aren't you asking him to reveal why you're not getting that thing? There is a reason why you're not getting it, and you have to ask him to reveal that to you. There are some things that you have to grow into.
Well, that's good.
When I was 14, 15 years old, and I was put in the game, and they put me in the front too fast, I already had all the strength. I already had all the know-how. But I believed that those things were bigger than me. But I could jump.
Oh, that's good.
I could do it then. I just didn't know it yet. Then I got to a place. Like Jacob got to a place where he's an old man now. And when he was little, he fought his brother all the way out of the womb. He fought for the inheritance. He fought for the birthright. He fought with his father-in-law for his wife, for his second wife, for all the animals, for all that was his. He fought all that time.
That's right.
And when he's all, you're thinking he's going to be done, but he realizes something. He said, I will not let you go unless you declare a blessing on me. He asked him, what is your name? And he said, Jacob. And he said, your name shall no longer be Jacob, but Israel, for you have struggled with God and with men and have prevailed. Mm. I'm here to tell you today that Jacob was always Israel.
That's good. Uh-huh. That's good. That's good.
He was always Israel. And all that time that he went around and he moved and he ran, all that time, he didn't have to do all that because everything that God had deposited inside of him was there from the moment he was fighting in his mother's womb.
Come on now.
And he had to become Jacob in order to become Israel.
That's good.
Do you know what that means? That all the things that you have done,
absolutely,
all the things that happened to you, all the things that the places where people let you down were part of the process. All the times that you jumped and nothing happened. All the times that you showed up and nothing happened. Every time that you prayed and it felt like nothing was happening, you were becoming more of the person that God has called you to be. It has already been deposited inside of you.
Yes.
The you that you're here now is the new you already.
Absolutely.
And you want people to lay hands on you. You want people to pray for you. You want God to change you. He already changed you. You got to open your mind. You got to open your eyes. And you got to realize that you are already Israel. You are already Jacob all at the same time. Right now, in this moment, you are it. You are that person already. So now you're older. Jacob is older. And he fought with the angel of the Lord. Verse 31 says, now the sun rose on him as he passed Penuel, and he was limping because of his hip. He was able to do something in his old age that he could not do his whole entire life. There are some things that you have been wanting to do. And you probably were giving a chance before. When I played that game, I couldn't jump because I didn't know who I was. I didn't know how high I could jump. I didn't know that I had the strength. But now that I've been through, that I got out of the game, God is putting me back in the game.
Amen,
you
amen.
You know why? Because he knows I can jump.
Yeah.
Because he knows that I know that I can jump now.
That's good.
Because he knows that I've been jumping. And he knows that I have been that person since the beginning of time. And now he can trust me. Now he can trust me. I have become the person that he has called me to be. There comes a time in your life where you have to say enough is enough.
Oh, that's good.
Right.
Enough is enough.
Enough is enough. There's no more settling. You can't settle anymore. Just can't settle anymore. So I'm gonna leave you with this bold prayer that I wrote. And I don't know what areas of your life you have to change. I don't know where you're struggling the most. I have no idea. You know. You know, I don't know. God knows. What does fighting like Jacob look like? Fighting like Jacob is standing up for what you want. Fighting is praying with conviction and expectation. Knowing that when we ask God for something that is in complete alignment with what he wants for us, he will give it to us. F-A-S-T, fast.
Come on now.
Yes, God.
Want to see what such prayer looks like? Let me just give you the prayer. And I want you to say this if you can. Just listen, and I want you to be saying it in your mind. Father, this ends today. For far too long, I have hurt others and myself. For far too long, I have prayed lukewarm prayers because the truth is that I knew you would forgive me. The truth is that I wanted to do what I wanted to do. I was impatient, callous, juvenile, and reckless. Those things served me for a season or two. I was able to get away with so much because I have your favor in my life. I'm likable. There, I said it. But that's no longer working for me. I want more. Say, I want more.
I want more.
I no longer want the leftovers or the partial blessings.
That's good.
I want the whole blessing. I want the whole blessing.
I want the whole blessing.
I now want everything you have set aside for me.
Hallelujah.
Anything else that looks like a microwave or fast food meal no longer appeals to me. I want what you want for me, and I want it today.
Today.
He has been available for me from day one.
My God.
But I just didn't know how to ask for it.
Yes.
And let's face it, I was not ready for it either. But today, say today.
Today.
I finally understand whose I am.
Yeah.
Finally, I get my inheritance, and it is a great one. Father, bless me so I can bless others. Erase my inequities so I can stand for others that can't. Bless me so I can testify of your goodness and endless mercies.
Yeah.
Father, today I come to you with thanksgiving in my heart because you delight in giving me what you have set aside for me all along.
Yes.
Remove the taste of falsehood and half-baked blessings from my mouth. Jesus.
From my mouth, yes, Lord God.
Erase all memory of my dalliances that have brought shame and brokenness to me, and those involved in my sinning debauchery. I thank you in advance because I know you are the God of the suddenly.
Yes.
You give the word and the earth responds and hops to do your bidding. Thank you for aligning my will to your will, for waking me up and showing me the light. I'll stand in this place with this prayer on my lips until it comes to pass. This is the day you have made. I will rejoice and be glad in it.
Amen.
There are some things that you need to embrace about who you are. And there are other things that you have to let go of.
Yeah.
And you get to decide if today is the day that you have, that you get to let go of those things. You get to decide if you are ready to become Jacob, no matter how ridiculous it looks. It's your decision. God has already been ready. He's been waiting for you to wake up. So no longer can you say, I don't know anymore. Now you know that you are Jacob, that you are a fighter. You have been a fighter. And it's okay to be a fighter. You have been fighting that thing because you want to be peaceful. You want to be a person that gets along with everybody. That is not who you are.
Oh, yeah.
And you have heard now from Pastor Russia. You have heard from Tina. And you have heard it today. This is the time to be who God created you to be.
Amen.
But you have to have the faith to trust that he's going to meet you there.
Mm.
He has put those things outside of your comfort zone. He is the ultimate setter. And you have to believe that even though the ball is outside of where you are, when you jump, he's going to supernaturally move you so you can meet that ball at the right time. At the right time. But you're going to have to move. You're going to have to jump when it looks crazy. You're going to have to move when it makes no sense to anybody else. It doesn't make sense. It doesn't make sense to anybody else. It just doesn't. It just doesn't. And that's okay. That's okay. We know what the inheritance is. We know how sweet it is. We know. So we don't have to make excuses anymore. We don't have to explain it anymore. God is ready. Are you ready to jump?
My God.
Father,
oh God.
Today we're ready to journey.
Thank you, God.
Father, you have spoken today loud and clear.
Yes.
You want to use us in a mighty, mighty way. And Father, it doesn't look like we thought it was going to look like. Father, we're tired. Father, the warfare has been crazy and a half. But Father, we know that we're close.
Yes.
You're going to bring us all the way to the end. You said that you were going to bring us there and you would not leave us until we see it come to pass. So, Father, I'm jumping until I see it.
Huh.
Father, I'm going to jump until I see it. Father, I'm going to jump until I see it because I believe what you said. I believe what you said. I am no longer who they said I was. I am becoming the person that you created me to be from the moment you put me in my mother's womb. I am a fire. I have been released. The door is already open. We don't have to keep waiting on cue, waiting for somebody else to open the door. We have been released.
Yes, oh God.
Father, we pray that every person that has heard this today believes it and acts accordingly. We ask for these things in the mighty, precious name of Jesus. Amen.
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 And amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.